November 7th marks the 104th anniversary of the October Revolution, when the workers and peasants overthrew the rule of the capitalists and landowners and were the first in the world to embark on the path of creating a socialist state. This victory was preceded by decades of stubborn struggle of the workers for socialism, the Revolution of 1848 in Europe, the Paris Commune, and the Revolution of 1905 in Russia. However, they all ended in defeat. In the near future, we will release a large and detailed overview of the death of the Russian Empire, the revolutions in Russia, and the Bolsheviks coming to power. Today, we will briefly go over the main points and answer the question, why did the October Revolution become possible, and how did the Bolsheviks take power? All revolutions are made up of objective and subjective factors. At the beginning of the First World War, the Russian Empire was in a tangle of contradictions. Despite the active development of capitalist relations, many feudal vestiges remained in Russia. Among the peasants, who made up the majority of the country's population, there was an active stratification. According to statistics, by the beginning of the 20th century, only a third of 45 million peasants found an application for their work in agriculture. Few of them grew rich and turned into kulaks, the countryside bourgeoisie, who used hired labor and actively enslaved their fellow villagers. Most of the peasants, suffering from land shortages and tyranny of the landowners, went to work, becoming farm laborers or workers. However, the workers did not fare any better. Irregular working hours, unemployment, low wages, and harsh working conditions were constant companions of their lives. In addition, both workers and peasants were deprived of full education and qualified medical care. National oppression was added to the economic one. Tsarism pursued a policy of Russification of the peoples of Poland, Finland, Siberia, the Caucasus, Central Asia, and suppressed their national culture. Anti-Semitism flourished in the country. Jews were forbidden to live outside the pale of settlement, and pogroms were frequent. This policy led to the natural growth of the National Liberation Movement in the imperial outskirts, undermining the forces of Tsarism. In an effort to subjugate other peoples, Tsarist Russia tried to expand into China, Korea, and Iran. At the same time, Russia itself was economically dependent on other imperialists, primarily Great Britain and France. The entry of the Russian Empire into the First World War, imposed by its creditors, exacerbated these contradictions, adding the hunger, deaths of hundreds of thousands of people, and the disruption of the economy. By 1917, they reached their limit. During the February Revolution, the monarchy was destroyed by a popular uprising. Using the experience of 1905, the workers, soldiers, and peasants created a democratic revolutionary organ of power, the Soviets. On the night of March 1st and 2nd, the Provisional Committee of the Russian Parliament and the Socialist Revolutionary and Menshevik leaders of the Executive Committee of the Petrograd Soviet secretly agreed to form a new government in Russia, a bourgeois provisional government. A dual power was developed in the country. Officially, state power belonged to the provisional government, but the real power was on the side of the Soviets. Without their agreement, not a single law could be issued. The provisional government talked about the need for social reforms and peace, but in fact, they did everything possible to prevent this. The leaders of the Soviets, the Mensheviks and SRs, followed the lead of the capitalists and did not seek to defend the demands of the working people. For example, the leaders of the Soviets opposed the introduction of an 8-hour working day until it became clear that the workers were introducing it on their own in the factories. Ultimately, they became part of the provisional government in order to prevent the further development of the revolution. The war continued, but no persuasion of the capitalists and their accomplices could force the soldiers to fight. The offensive, planned for June 1917, ended in a heavy defeat for Russia. The government, led by Kerensky, hastened to shift the responsibility for this to the Soviets, which responded with large-scale demonstrations against the capitalists. Reactionary generals began to prepare a coup with the aim of destroying the Soviets and suppressing the revolution. By the fall of 1917, it became clear that the former Russian Empire was in a protracted crisis, the way out of which was either in a reactionary military dictatorship or in the dictatorship of the proletariat. The situation in the country was difficult. However, not all crises end in revolutions. The subjective factor that influenced the revolution was the Bolshevik Party. The concept of Bolshevism arose in connection with the elections at the Congress of the Russian Social Democratic Labor Party in 1903, when Lenin's supporters were the majority and the opportunists were the minority. Despite the harsh conditions of Tsarism, the Bolsheviks fought not only against the autocracy and capitalists, but also against other leftist currents, the Narodniks, socialist revolutionaries, Mensheviks. In those days, just as now, the opponents of the communists, calling themselves Marxists, denigrated and perverted the teachings of Marx in every possible way. The Bolsheviks were accused of dogmatism, radicalism, and sectarianism. The fate of the labor movement and the revolution depended on the outcome of this struggle. Relying on Marxist theory, the Bolsheviks, led by Lenin, did an enormous amount of work to study contemporary society. Every event of that era is reflected in their works. Let's highlight some of them. As capitalism developed, it had turned into imperialism, which preserved old contradictions and created new ones. The struggle between the world powers inevitably led to a redistribution of markets, the manifestation of which was the World War. The uneven economic development meant the possibility of revolution in one, not even the most developed country. However, this required a party. Huge profits enabled the bourgeoisie to bribe the wealthiest workers and the union bureaucracy into becoming their agents in the labor movement. The opportunists strove to give a theoretical explanation of their actions, and for this purpose, they interpreted the teachings of Marx in a way favorable to them. Their dominance in the social democratic parties led the workers to an agreement with the bourgeoisie and thus defeat in the struggle against capital. To avoid this, the workers need a vanguard party that includes the most class-conscious and active representatives of the proletariat and other working people. It was for the creation of such a party that Lenin and his comrades fought. The Bolshevik Party became such a party. They not only defended Marxism from the attacks of opportunists, but also applied it to modern conditions. Marxism-Leninism generalized the experience of the revolutionary movement in Russia and around the world, and embodied the unity of theory and practice. The Bolsheviks took an active part in the development of the labor movement in Russia. The Revolution of 1905, the reaction that followed, and the pre-war upsurge of the labor movement became a test of the Bolshevik principles in relation to reality. After the start of the imperialist war, the RSDLP found itself underground due to its active anti-war position. In contrast to the opportunists, who called on the workers to die for their fatherland, the Bolsheviks carried out consistent agitation to end the war between the working people of different countries and turn it into a war against the imperialism that gave birth to it. Tsarism responded by banning the party and arresting its deputies in the State Duma. The Bolsheviks went underground, but did not stop in their activities. During the war, they continued to conduct anti-war agitation and take part in the labor movement. Speaking of the February Revolution, people usually point to the domination of the socialist revolutionaries and the Mensheviks during this period. The history of the Bolsheviks seems to be full of various accidents and coincidences, as a result of which an allegedly unknown handful of revolutionaries seized power over the country. As we've seen, the Bolsheviks were a notable force in the pre-revolutionary labor movement. Their relatively small numbers at the time of the collapse of Tsarism is explained by the fact that the opponents of the Bolsheviks, the socialist revolutionaries and Mensheviks, supported the Tsarist government in entering the First World War, because of which they were given the ability to act freely. By the beginning of 1917, in some cities, Bolshevik groups consisted of tens or even less people. However, the small number of Bolsheviks did not prevent them from taking an active part in the events of February and March 1917. For example, they played an important role in organizing workers' demonstrations in Petrograd, which served as a signal for the start of the revolution. Many members of the Bolshevik Party went through the 1905 revolution, the years of reaction and war. In addition, two-thirds of the party were workers, which facilitated the work of organizing the masses. It was these people, hardened in the class struggle, that became the backbone around which the mass party quickly grew. If by February 1917, 24,000 people were members of the RSDLP, then by April, it had grown to 100,000 people. Contrary to all speculation, the Bolsheviks had a clear goal and knew what conditions were necessary to achieve it. Unlike the compromisers, who are ready to abandon the ultimate goal for the sake of momentary political and economic benefits, Marxist-Leninists changed their tactics in accordance with the constantly changing conditions of struggle and the alignment of forces. However, The goal, the transfer of power to the majority of the working people, and the abolition of all exploitation of man by man, remains the same. This explains the actions of the Bolsheviks, which may seem to contradict each other. In April 1917, Lenin, the leader and chief theoretician of the party, returned from emigration. In his famous April theses, he formulated the party's strategy, the development of the bourgeois democratic revolution into a socialist one. The alliance of the proletariat with the poor peasantry against the bourgeoisie of town and country, while neutralizing the vacillating middle peasantry. The well-known slogan put forward by him, "All power to the Soviets," at that time meant the peaceful development of the socialist revolution. It may seem that Lenin ignored the compromising leadership of the Soviets, which at that time consisted mainly of socialist revolutionaries and Mensheviks. In conditions when the political activity of the masses was high, and the Soviets had tremendous influence, power could have been passed on peacefully. The Bolsheviks developed active political activity among workers, peasants, soldiers, and sailors, in the Soviets, soldiers' committees, trade unions, educational societies, and factory committees. Gradually, they liberated more and more layers of working people from the influence of the opportunists. After the July crisis, when the opportunists openly turned the Soviets into an appendage of the government, the slogan was withdrawn. However, the reactionary Kornilov revolt that followed the crisis gave them new strength and diminished the influence of the compromisers. The words "all power to the Soviets" became relevant again, and this is just one example of the flexible tactics of the communists. At different stages of the revolution, the party used peaceful and non-peaceful, legal and illegal means of struggle, showing the ability to combine them, the ability to move from one form and method to another. This is one of the fundamental differences between Leninism, reformism, and adventurism. By the fall of 1917, the Bolsheviks approached those most prepared for the struggle for power. The party consisted of more than 300,000 people. The RSDLP enjoyed immense popularity among ordinary workers and soldiers. The Soviets sided with the Bolsheviks, and the provisional government lost all confidence, as did the compromising parties. In the course of a carefully prepared uprising in Petrograd, supported by the Red Guard, sailors, and soldiers, power in the country finally passed to the Soviets. As we can see, the revolution was the result of many years of work by the Bolsheviks in the field of theory and practice. Combining objective and subjective factors and approaching each event from a scientific point of view, they united in one stream the struggle for socialism, for peace, for land, against oppression, and directed these forces to overthrow the capitalist system. As a result of the victory of the revolution in Russia, for the first time in history, a socialist country had emerged. Bolshevism has stood the test of time. Therefore, it is especially important for communists of our time to know what and how their predecessors did to successfully achieve their goals. The experience of the Bolsheviks has shown that only the vanguard party can influence public life and unite broad sections of the working people around itself. Such a party can only be created by methodical and persistent work in the field of theory and practice. This work was done by the Bolsheviks, and now the modern communists have to go through the same process. Every year, events require us to be organized and prepared for new challenges. On this anniversary of the October Revolution, the editorial board of Politstorm calls on all class-conscious workers and communists to join this work in our ranks and contribute to the restoration of the world communist movement. Stay tuned.